welcome back to the series on key text in humanities and social sciences. And let us remind ourselves that we are doing a series on trying to look into the debates and discussions of few of the texts in humanities and social sciences. Our objective of doing this series is to look into the context, the production and distribution of this text, so as to understand the core theorization of certain institutions, process and organizations that so many of our thinkers around has done it. And this is the reason why we need to look into these texts, the original classical text, with a mind to increase our understanding of this these books and start kind of reading and rereading some of the texts which are very critical for increasing our knowledge and information of the society around us. And in this series today, I'm going to talk about a very important classical book of 20th century, that is The Gift by Marcel Mauss. The complete title of the book is Marcel Mauss, Forms and Functions of Exchange in Archaic Society. And it's an interesting text which has been done by an anthropologist. Before I go into the text, it's very important to keep in mind the environment around us, the time and space around us. And we see that today is a time when we are just beginning the entire month of festivity around us. And very soon we'll be seeing all around people going and giving gifts, to the extent that even gift has become central to the economy, to the corporate sector. Everybody around would be gifting gift on the occasion of Diwali. So it's important to understand what is the whole idea of gift. So we look into this book, which is written by a French anthropologist called Marcel Mauss. And when we go into the text, let us keep in mind that he is an anthropologist and contributed extensively to the understanding of a so-called primitive simple society. And in anthropology, just after kinship, the system of exchange was very crucial for understanding society. Why? Because these societies were lacked centralized state and any systemized organization. So the general understanding was this: in these societies, the society is full of disorder and are generally they lack political kind of a will. But when we look into such readings, we try to understand that even in primitive society, without centralized state, without systemized system, there was a kind of a method or a communication through which the political neutrality between states or communities were maintained. And even social institutions to a large extent help us to also understand the ways in which communities moved or got commodities across space in order to survive the living. What is very critical before I start looking into what Marcel Mauss has said in the book is to try to look into the context of the production of this book, and that is to keep in mind it was a time when there was a kind of a evolutionary theory in anthropology which were trying to explain a kind of an evolution of simple society to a complex society. And in that, within that, we see there was a kind of a disjunction between primitive society having a different kind of economy, having a different kind of political system, having a different kind of social institutions. And one of the central criteria of differentiating a simple society from a complex society was obviously economic institution, where it was argued that in simple society there was no concept of market, there was no concept of material exchange of goods with a monetary value, and therefore the idea was that gift was only kind of being something which was done for the purpose of social communication or cultural context. And that is the reason why anthropologists were of opinion that simple society had a barter exchange, and the modern complex society where exchange included monetary benefit, and it was always in terms of a contract that was signed between two parties, and therefore complex societies were characterized as having a kind of a market economy. This book by Marcel Mauss help us to negate this idea of the idea of different kinds of economy or with the, and the whole idea that there is a kind of disjunction between the social and the economy. And here we see the embeddedness of economy. It is that, and he will be arguing throughout the book that exchange, though might be voluntary, but within it has the element of contract, and it is obligatory for individuals to exchange gift. So with this background, let us look into the beautiful text by Marcel Mauss, The Gift. This book is basically a comparative study of the institution of gift, and he looks through ethnographic examples into a large number of exchange system to arrive at his understanding of what is actually a gift, what is the purpose behind individual gift giving and taking gift, and the most significant is that it will look into the function of gift in the society. So it explores the economy of pre-capitalist culture. Let's this is to take you back to what I began by, trying to kind of classify society into a pre-capitalist and a capitalist culture. Would be a pre-capitalist culture or a society would be society in which the production was done for self-consumption. The market was not present, and therefore the production, distribution and consumptions were basically not separate from each other. First, with when we come into the capitalist culture, we see means of production shifting from private means to community means of ownership to a private means of property ownership, where we start having the capitalist class, which are the owners of the means of productions. And if we look into the extent through which this text traverses, we look into it, Mauss has looked into Melanesia, Polynesia and the Pacific Northwest. He is taking examples from each of the society to give us a very illustrative idea of what is gift in primitive and simple society. He started his book with the guiding question. He began with a number of questions that were very crucial when we begin, because we remember when the time that Marcel Mauss is writing the book, gift was considered as something very different from economic society. It was something different and was not kind of theorized very seriously. And therefore, the question that comes into his mind is in primitive archaic types of society, what is the principle whereby the gift received has to be repaid? That is, he is trying to look into the opposition between voluntary and obligatory to return. It was kind, we will be looking in through different examples, where if a group or a community gives a gift to someone, there is an obligation to return it back. So he is trying to look into this hidden idea of why would community return the gift. And this is not something which we could restrict to simple society. Even today we see there is a kind of equation which goes on when we looking around people gifting each other. We only try to gift to people who gifts us, and thereby trying to why are we returning that gift is trying to establish a relationship with the person who has gifted us. So this is the question that he is looking in the primitive society. The second question that Marcel Mauss raises is, what force is there in thing given which compels the recipient to make a return? So he will be actually talking about certain kind of invisible force which is not actually cannot be grasped in terms of reality, but this is something abstract. This is something which is existing, which is kind of pressurizing or exerting an external pressure on individual to return the gift. So what would actually be the answer to these questions is, when we'll go through the entire text, we'll see that through different experiences, through ethnographic examples, Marcel Mauss arrives at a definition, kind of an understanding of gift as a total social fact. So if we look into this total social fact, we'll try to understand that Marcel Mauss is a nephew of M.I. Durkheim, and he has worked very closely with M.I. Durkheim. And this concept of social fact, as has been discussed in the previous lecture, is a kind of a way in which we understand the social phenomena around us. So he's also looking at gift as a social fact imbued with spiritual mechanism, engaging the honor of both giver and receiver. So it has three important components: that it is a part of a social fact, which in the sense that Durkheim gives us the three features of social facts, is that it is upright, that it exists prior to us, it is external to individual, and thirdly, it exerts a pressure on individual to do the way they are doing it. And that kind of commitment to do certain act in a way described by the society is being described in terms of something which is spiritual, something which is within the individual, which is the is outside the purview of kind of a theorization or scientific explanation. But then it does not deny the fact that the study is a scientific application of scientific method to understand, because the whole idea is that he is raising certain question which he is going to explain through solid kind of an arguments in the text. So, what was he basically trying to do? He was basically searching for the origin of Western system of transaction, the base of a social life. That is, we were kind of, let us remind ourselves that he is writing at a time when comparative method was very significant in anthropology, and most of these scholars were trying to compare two society, and one of the most important comparison that was a part of social and anthropological research was the comparison of the Western society to the kind of Eastern society or the developed society and the developing society. And here, though, trying to understand the Western system of transaction was to understand the emergence of the market-based economy, which became a guiding principle of individual life. He was contesting the idea that there is a natural economy, that in the state of nature or in primitive life, an individual acts like a self-interested bartering unit. Well, the whole idea is he will reject the idea there is any kind of a natural economy, because the whole idea of any kind of transaction is with the whole, long carries with the idea of obligation, morality, commitment, and therefore even in a monetary transaction, these elements are to be found. So then what is that Mauss calls the gift? A gift is an item given within a complex set of social relations and institution, which at the same time comprises those relations and institution. To make it simple, it is trying to understand in kind of a medium or a mechanism to build relation, to build, negotiate individual or kind of attach individual to the collective, and that kind of bring in the sense of belongingness. It is only acts as a kind of a communication medium, and therefore we try to understand that communication need not necessarily always be through linguistic. It is also through the ways in which members behave and relate to each other. Gifts are never free. This again, whole the idea is of it, if we bring it back to the kind of a understanding prior to Mauss, was that gifts are something which is given voluntary. So gifts are something which would be given freely to people. There is no kind of an obligation to take a kind of compensation on it. But Mauss says that gifts are never free. It, rather, human history is full of example that gives rise to reciprocal exchange. And from here, we try to understand the significance of the text is that it will help us to not only kind of understand the life of simple society, but it also help us to understand very important concepts like reciprocity, exchange, transactions. And this brings us to a very important concept, argument is that most of us in the kind of compartmentalized discipline and the body of knowledge into different disciplines like sociology, economics, philosophy, psychology, etc. Here we see a text which is going to cut across discipline, and therefore he is not only talking about anthropological per se, but he is integrating with his discussion economy, philosophy, psychology, and so on. And this brings out the reason why the text is considered as one of the classical texts in anthropology. The original work, that is the original book gift, was titled in Essai sur les dons from Ete Desne. That, and it was translated into the English language. It was originally published in La Sociologique, which he was Marcel Mauss was a part of it with Emile Durkheim, And the book was for the first time published in 1925. It was later republished in French in 1950, and the English version of the book was available only in 1954 with the translation done by Jan Kunesen. And then the English version had an introduction by Mary Douglas, who beautifully describes the significant contribution that Marcel Mauss has done to the discipline of anthropology. When we look into the content or we go inside the books, we see the content is basically has the four can be divided into four sections. The first is exchange of gifts and the obligation to reciprocate. In this chapter, he begins with the whole idea or he starts raising these questions which we dealt, why do we have the compulsions to return gift and what is the force which help us to kind of give and take gift. So, the entire chapter is dedicated to the understanding of gift as obligation. Gift as a kind of symbolic of power, as symbolic of competition of and strategy. The second chapter is a kind of extension of the analysis through the example. Some of the examples that he discusses in the text are the cooler system, which to remind us that the in anthropology, the study of exchange and gift as exchange, system of exchange was kind of common to us, and it began with the understanding of Malinowski is the agronaut of Western Pacific. And if we go back to this series, the text by Malinowski has been already discussed. But to quickly go into Malinowski is that he would be discussing the cooler system as a non-economic form of system among the Trobriand, and he discusses the way in which it helps to negotiate certain kind of relations and leads to the stability of the society of the Trobriand. The third chapter of Marcel Mauss' book is looks into the survival of these principles in Asian systems of laws and Asian economy. He goes into China, German, Indian laws to bring us to the whole idea that kind of a methodological significance, in the sense that he is trying to tell us that the past helps us to understand the present. One, two, second, he is trying to tell us that it is not something that should be very specific or unique to the primitive society. Though the discussion is around the primitive society, the discussions are flows across before these societies and also carried on later on. In the last section of the book, that is on the conclusion, he will come to an kind of an understanding or a kind develop a relation between gift and social democracy, and that is kind of the where we gauge the significance of the text in terms of understanding how something like which we considered as a part of everyday activity would help us to understand the political domain of the society. Then let us go briefly into the four different sections that Malinowski is looking into. And for in that instance, let us try to understand his understanding of gift as obligatory and mutual. Even the idea of a pure gift is contradiction. By ignoring the universal custom of compulsory gifts, we make our own record incomprehensible to ourselves. Right across the globe, as far as we can go in the history of human civilization, the major transfer of good has been cycle of obligatory return of gift. That is the whole idea, as I have already said, that what was the notion behind the people actually either giving a gift was to always have that idea that the thing given would come back. It actually served to multiple functions in the society, but the most important thing was that this was a society where kind of transportation was not there. So, it was a kind of circulation of commodities from one place to another, from one group for another, which was very essential for the survival of the society. So, according to Mauss, the most important understanding of gift is that it is obligatory, and in that context, the gift is based on three obligations. the first obligation is to give. That is, I have to give. When we look at it at an individual level, at a collective level kind of a thing, when it is kind of being shared by a number of individual, it could be we have to give. The second is obligation to receive. So, once the whole idea of the gift being given is the idea that once we have given, we need to receive. And this can be explained from our contemporary society where we see where we have birthdays and the person whose birthday is being celebrated gets a gift. And so, we all have this whole notion of return gift. So, the person who gives you a gift will again get back a gift. So, the idea was actually to, in the modern context, when we look into or we kind of debate why is the whole notion of return given, is to compensate the whole monetary burden which an individual had to in kind of purchasing a gift, and that can get established. The second idea of why there could be an obligation to gift is also to establish a relationship. Gifts would be given obviously among individuals who are known to each other, and therefore by giving a gift in return would acknowledge this kind of a relationship which is existing among the individual. The third obligation is the obligation to return. It must give back another gift. Anything that involves the three obligations considered a gift. To make it simple, it says that an individual gives a return gift and has the obligation that kind. There is a kind of a moral duty to ensure that at least the same kind of gift is returned to that individual. And again, we see this is nothing, something which we could ascribe it only to a primitive society, because in modern society also, if we are very observant, we see around in marriages people noting down the amount of monetary gift which is given to the brides and bridegrooms. And obviously, why do people make a note of it is also obviously to keep an account of the amount that comes in, but more than important, it serves a social purpose, and that is the amount would be returned in times of a parlance, equal parlance. That is, if somebody has paid a kind of one amount, the same amount or a higher amount would be paid to the individual. So, when we look into this whole idea that any kind of can be considered as gift when all the three obligations are present. When we elaborate Marcel Mauss' understanding of gift, we see that he considers gift as a total phenomena. It can be found in different areas of life: economic, cultural, moral, social, legal. So, this is again to elaborate whole idea that we used to limit our understanding of gift only to social occasions like wedding, birth and kind. But here we will see that it is elaborated in the sense it is an economic part of the society. It involves moral and legal elements as well. These areas of life are not separate from one another, and this brings us the significance of trying to do away with compartmentalization or classification of either disciplines of institutions in life, and for a beautiful able to have a holistic understanding of any society or the functioning of institutions and association, it is important to have a kind of a transdisciplinary or transinstitutional perspective and bring in the elements of all together to understand it. The gift shows how objects play the role of establishing relations between people. So, this is one of the significant functions that gift in society performs, and I have already repeatedly said that the reason why one would have the obligation to give and receive gift is to kind of strengthen or build on the relation which is existing between two individual or two groups. But even when the gift seems to be freely given, it has a compulsory aspect, and that is to again go back to the idea that there are no gift which is considered to be free, because anybody who gives a gift will have the compulsion to return it back, and that returning element is something which will be discussed in detail what forces individuals to return the gift. Then we look into gift as competitive and strategic. Gift giving is grounded in the morality, and by giving and receiving and returning gifts, a moral bond is created between the persons exchanging gift. And this is what is again central to Durkheim. And to again repeat in a kind of, I say that Marcel Mauss was both a student and a nephew of Emile Durkheim, who has given his work on the concept of morality, where he was kind of trying to build in the collective morale of the society, and his even his discussions of elementary forms of religious life, he gives too much of focus on the concept of morality, how individuals sense of moral life becomes a kind of a regulatory conditions for the society to functions in a kind of a smooth and in a solidarity manner. So, taken from Durkheim, Marcel Mauss says that gift also has an element of morality. That is, the moment we receive a gift, morally we feel obliged to return the gift. And it is kind of a dual sword. So, we were morally obliged to return the field, and the moment we return the gift, it kind of re-strengthens the relationship between two individuals. Because many a time, even if in our everyday life, we have seen that if a person gives a gift to a friend or a relative and does not get back a return, there is a kind of distrust, there is a kind of idea sets into the mind that the so-and-so is not kind of person who can be trusted, is not kind of a friend. So, in that context, gift can be seen as a kind of a friendship, which is kind of a two-way communication. So, you can only be friend as long as there is a kind of trust and communication from both sides. So, in that context, it becomes also very competitive in the sense that and this competitiveness will help us look very closely to the modern economy, because there is a kind of a feeling that if one has given a certain variety or a certain brand of gift, the competition would be to give a higher quality of a higher value attached to it, or the whole idea that it is kind of a indicator of your status and prestige. So, you cannot give something a gift which is of low value, because from the gift that you give, the individuals are going to arrive at a kind of an judgment of the kind of person that you are. So, therefore, you can bring in the notion of competition, and it keeps a contest between two individuals. So, Mauss emphasizes the competitive and strategic aspect of gift giving. By giving more than one's competitors, one claims to greater respect than them, and give gift giving contest. So, when we look into the gift in terms of the moral, competitive and contesting aspect, we also try to understand the whole idea of hidden invisible force, which is trying to make individual have the obligation to return. And in this context, Mauss looks into gift as in terms of moral and spiritual. So, the moral and the spiritual dimension of the gift giving, by looking into the example of the Maori, which is a tribal society. And to bring into keep in mind that most of the ethnographic studies were being done in the kind of tribal societies of Africa, Africans, New Zealand, Australian society. So, the Maori have perceived gift as possessing spirits, which is considered as how, and that expect reciprocation. If the recipients did not return a gift, the spirit could be angered. The whole idea of spirit was to be understood in terms of something which was related to our ancestral, and therefore, if we did not return kind of gift to somebody, the idea was that the ancestor would get annoyed and therefore would bring about kind of harm the individual. So, there is a kind of a fear, or there is kind of again an invisible force which is making individual return the gift. If spirits inhabiting objects sound strange, consider why Marilyn Monroe dress sold for so much at auction. It's just cloth, but because some people believe her life force imbues it, they will pay a lot of money. This is just to explain the whole idea that there is a different kind of an understanding about spirits and souls in the in modern context, where people don't believe in these ideas. But when we look into anthropological literatures, we see the kind of explain the kinship relation between those living and those who are not among us in terms of the idea of spirit and souls, and the whole idea that they could be, even Durkheim is talking in his text in the Elementary Forms of Religious Life, that they are kind of spirits which are roaming all around, and there's a belief among individual that these spirits are no one but lost individual who were at one point of a time member of the same clan, and therefore to idea kind these as the belief that these spirits are not only kind of roaming around, but they are in part of every object, every individuals, and that they, these spirit is a force which is trying to make individual do certain kind of work. When we look into Durkheim, this is very similar to what Durkheim is making reference to mana, the Wakan, and where he's calling the mana as the invisible physical force, which is kind of forcing individual to believe in the kind of the totem, which is considered as an ancestor, and to believe in the totem as a kind of responsible for the entire life around them. And mana, which is which Durkheim describes in his text as invisible, external, and exerting pressure on the individual to behave in certain moral collective manner. Then another element of gift is the whole idea of power, and this is again brings into significant of trying to have a interrelated perspective to arrive at a holistic theorization of any institutions or process. The objects and service exchanged in primitive gift giving are laden with power. The Polynesian words mana and hau are used to refer to this power in the gift. This again brings into the whole idea being borrowed from Durkheim, where Durkheim is saying that the mana and the hau are all sacred, and he gives in a kind of a explanation of sacred, where he considers sacred to be something which is up in the hierarchy, and it is considered to be more powerful than those that are profane, and it is the mana or the hau which is considered to be also high in the kinship chart, because they are kind of an ancestor, they have a power over the other members of the society. So when we are exchanging gifts, which kind of is imbibed with this idea of spirits or mana or invisible force, it is kind of arriving at an understanding that gifts are not kind of lifeless objects. They kind of translate or they transfer power from one to the other. Although a similar power is present to certain extent in modern gift as well, Mauss shows that gifts in traditional societies are more complex and multivalent than anything we know from the modern society. So then, we know the more another added feature or the kind of characteristic of gift is that it is a non-contractual contract. This is, let me go back to where I began and trying to say that we were trying to understand that gifts are free, voluntary, and non-contractual, because when we are exchanging gift, we are kind of not entering into any kind of agreement or contract between two parties, but it is kind of a gift which is being exchanged on mutual trust and faith, and therefore is kind of though there is no kind of a written contract, there is a kind of a existence of a non-contractual contract while exchanging gift. These exchanges in primitive societies were not only exchange of good and wealth, but mostly of banquets, rituals, military services, women, children, dance, festivals, and fairs. In this system, the economical transaction does not play the central role, but it is mere aspect of the greater and enduring contract. Here the contract in the sense of kind of the moment an individual gives you a gift, you kind of enter into a relation with the other individual, and the contract is that you need to carry on that relation through by kind of returning a gift to them. Now, in the we come to the second section of the book, where he tries to begin with a lot of examples to explain the idea of understanding of gift as a total phenomena, obligatory, spiritual, moral, and powerful. So, the first example is the samao gifts, and of any kind, material or ritual, contain a part of person's spiritual essence. Keeping and not reciprocating them would be highly dangerous and immoral, because active gift seeks to return to the original owner and to the place of origin. This is the whole idea that there is a kind of, even when we look into the idea of exchange, in the sense that it could be kind of going to a person and coming back to that person, and that is the idea why there is kind of materials which are being moving from one person or groups to the other person. The second example is the kula exchange. As I already said, the kula exchange is an exchange system which was analyzed or studied through an ethnographic research by Malinowski in his work Trobriand, the Agronauts of Western Pacific. This is the Andaman Islanders or the Trobriand Islanders, where he is talking about the gift exchange between, it's an intertribal and intratribal trade which is called kula. Kula means circle, because the ceremonial objects, goods, food, everything is circulating in a circle, and it is kind of establishing a relation between the individual and the group in the kula exchange. Kula means circle, a fact which indicates that all things are caught up in a circle. Following around this circle is a regular movement in time and space. According to Malinowski, culture existed to serve human needs, and therefore to bring in that Marcel Mauss being influenced by Durkheim has been also majorly being influenced by Malinowski's functional analysis of cultural system, where Malinowski explains the functions of any culture in terms of the psychological needs. And he says that the kula exchange has fulfilled certain need, and first function was to create social alliance. In alliance, in the kind of marital relation between different group, it was creating social motivations for society. It was rooted in myth, backed by traditional law, surrounded by magical rites. So the whole idea that why did the people continue with the practice of kula ring was that it has a myth and a tradition, and therefore the idea was that if people did not follow the way their ancestors or their elders did it, the kind of the society could be in danger, and that led to the persistence of the exchange in these societies. And he also kind of explains this as a non-economic transaction carried out specifically for social purpose. The third example of gift exchange is the potlatch. The potlatch is a festivity that involves the giving of gift. The word potlatch means to give or gift, in kind of feast or a festival which is held where during the occasion of birth, wedding, death, etc. And during this festivity, there is lot of exchange of goods item among the people. They are only held by high ranking people. It is practiced by indigenous people of the Pacific North Coast of America. The article in exchange in a potlatch is the tonga. The potlatch was bringing the honor, prestige of or mana. So, just like the kula and the other kind of forms of exchange, it was also related to the idea of honor and prestige, and that is why we are saying that it is practiced among the noble group. So, the whole idea that there is a certain kind of class and element attached to gift exchange also becomes significant, and how it is not only helping us to understand reciprocity, but it is also helping us to understand the idea of kind of class relation among the individuals. Potlatch is what Mauss calls a total phenomenon. It is a religious, mythological, shamanic, juridical, economic, and a phenomena of social structure. So the reason, the whole idea to go back is to try to understand gift as a total phenomena, because it is not only related to one dimension or one aspect of society, but it is a kind of intertwined with all elements, kind of the economy, the political, the cultural, the social, as well as the judicial. The things exchanged during the potlatch, a power is present that forces gifts to be passed around to be given and returned. So again, you have the whole the idea of how and the mana. Even among these this community, the idea of power is present. In addition, each of these things possess productive power itself. It is a sign and pledge of wealth, the magical and religious symbol of lank and plenty. So we see that kind of negating the whole idea that in simple society was a kind of a holistic society which had a kind of own ways of negotiating alliance. It had a system of though this absence of state, it has a kind of way of balancing political relations among the community, and it also had a lot of significance attached to magic and religious element, where gift could be kind of seen as a symbolic of a kind of an honor or kind of a rank which was given, because certain, even in the Kula exchange, we see certain kind of objects were exchanged only among the nobles and the people from the upper class, and the commoners were detained from it. So the idea of kind of hierarchy or social stratification can also be understood by looking into the system of gift exchange. Especially copper objects were regarded as living. They have their own name, individuality and value. They also have a power of attraction between them. This kind of try to conceptualize non-material good in terms of fulfilling a certain kind of an function in the society, because each of these objects was an indication of certain amount of status and prestige attached to a certain group, and therefore they could speak for themselves. So the nature of the object being circulated among the individual could clearly give the identification of the class of that community, and therefore becomes significant in considering them as kind of living objects. It was more violent than the system of exchange in Melanesia, because this whole idea of power and prestige attached to it, so it cannot be without a competition and conflict. So every individual would actually want to acquire or would want to take part in that nature of gift exchange which was associated with a certain class, whereas those who were already at the upper rank would not allow those at the lower to take part in it, and from there emerges the nature of violence. Services performed during the potlatch gathering are seen as act of honor, and the chief can keep his high status only by sharing his good fortune. So not only kind of the nature of the object which was being exchanged would determine the class status of the group, but it was also in terms of the amount or the quality of the object which was being exchanged. And in order to retain the power or the status at which an individual was, they would kind of engage in more and more of such exchanges so that their status was maintained or nobody else. So there was a lot of competition, there was a lot of contestation over acquiring or over and participation in the exchange, which would indirectly kind of help us to understand the political and economic nature of the community. Another example of the system of gift exchange is the Pilau, which is a New Caledonia, a system which is kind of again associated with gift festivals, weddings, and kind of individual assembling together. Just like the potlatch, it's a kind of festival where individual exchange goods. It is a legal tie which makes things return. So here we have a legal element very strong, that is kind of judicially or legally individuals are kind of compelled to return the gift which is given to them. In the third section of the book, Marcel Mauss goes back to the ancient laws among the Roman, Hindu, German and Chinese to give us the significance of obligatory nature of exchange. So he says that in ancient Rome law, the term nexum, which refers to pledge, the things pledged are normally without value that are themselves animate. The contracting parties are bound by them. We can also say that the nexum was related to magic and things themselves had a personality in The Romans and the Greeks were the ones who distinguished between personal and real law, separated sale from gift and exchange. So, and it's not something which was kind of coming in with the coming in of modern society or the capitalist society. Even in the Asian society, there's a kind of a separation between a barter exchange and a kind of a market economy. But then the whole idea in both is that there is kind of obligation to complete the exchange which is taking place. In the classical Hindu law, Mauss is making reference to the law of the gift, which is refers to the Brahmins, to the way they solicit and receive a gift, and also to the way a gift is their due. So the whole idea of bhiksha or the kind of asking for alms by the Brahmin Karu is based on a system of reciprocal relation, that they were since contributing to a large extent in terms of the maintaining the hierarchy or leading to the kind of performing all the sacred duties, they in return demanded a service by the individual, and that was they would ask individuals to give them the alms or food, goods and services in return. So, before the iron colonization, India was a land of potlatch, but later what remained was this law in favor of the Brahmins. So, the whole system of caste system becoming legitimate in the society after the iron context and the establishment of Brahmin hegemony led to the potlatch becoming kind of less significant. So, the Brahmins' presence are obligatory, and it is considered as kind of a religious duty to give the Brahmin something, and it is considered, if we go through these lot of mythological texts, we see among the Hindus there is a kind of saying that whosoever comes at your door should not be returned empty handed, because it could be in the form of a god. So any Brahmin who comes at the door has to be returned something and given something, in the whole idea of obligation or religious moral obligation to feed the and ensure that the foods and goods are given to the Brahmins. In Germanic law, we find also the form of gift and the alliance by pledges and hostages, by feast and presents. For a long time, it was the only way people communicated, helped and allied themselves to one another. So the whole idea is that legally one was bound to return the return something back to the society, and that is the reason the pledge was being taken. So the pledge was in kind of a gift which was given to individual, and they had to return by doing service to the community. Mauss notes that the great number of work deriving from Geben and Wen in the German language. There are two institutions related to the subject, the Geben and the pledge. So these are references to laws in the German, which is very similar to what was happening in Melanesia and northwestern America and etc. So he's trying to arrive at a kind of uniformity of the idea of obligation to give to and to return in kind of across societies, from ancient Roman, German society, Indian society to the primitive societies. The pledge is compulsory, has little value, and is returned when payment for the things handed over has been made. The pledge binds also the honor, authority and manner of the one who hands it over. The latter remains in a position of inferiority so long as he is not freed from his pledge. The receiver also binds himself, and he receives the thing after it has been thrown at his feet. Therefore, the pledge holds danger for both parties. In the Chinese laws, we find an interesting element. When someone sells a thing, he preserves the right to weep for his property. So, this is based on the idea that contracting parties are deemed to be in a state of perpetual dependence towards one another. Mauss emphasizes through these ethnographic examples that the gift play a huge role in what he calls as total service of agnostic type. The system of exchange in several societies discussed by him serves to create and maintain social ties, reinforce laws and rights, and keep the society function in a certain way. So, to a large extent, we see the impression of both Malinowski and Durkheim very heavily on Mauss, where through his discussions or an ethnographic example, he is kind of drawing attention towards the functional utility of the gift exchange. In the last chapter, Mauss compares the notion of gift in the European society with that in societies of Melanesia and American Northwest. In the Western society, gifts are seen as something that should be given free, in contrast to obligation and services that should be reciprocated. However, we look at the history of Indian European law system, classical Hindu laws, Celtic laws and others, we will notice that the system of exchange and obligation is not foreign to them. Mauss believes that we can find goodness and happiness in simple things like maintenance of peace, harmonizing of joint and private work, gathered and distributed wealth, mutual respect and mutual generosity, which can be won through education. Like the market, this is something which Mary Douglas mentions in the introduction to the book, in the English translation of the book, The Gift. Like the market, gift supplies each individual with personal incentives for collaborating in the pattern of exchanges. Gifts are given in a context of public drama with nothing secret about them. So this is not so the whole idea of kind to delegate a gift to the domestic or the private sphere is again questionable, and there is a kind of a similarity with the economic exchange, where the both economic monetary exchange and gift exchange is kind of making individual take personal incentives in doing that exchange. In being more directly cued to public esteem, the distribution of honor and sanction of religion, the gift economy is more visible than the market. So, when we look into the 3-4 section of the book, we try to understand why are we kind of debating and discussing a book called The Gift, and this is to bring into the importance of the work. The first importance is that it brings into a kind of a logical structured communication system. So, it is kind of not only communications through language or through kind of it helps us to kind of understand the interpersonal relations, the exchange of goods and services and many more. The concept of social phenomena in anthropological theory. So, this would kind of reject the idea that this is kind of compartmentalized or there is a kind of every section has to be analyzed separately. The concept of multidimensional phenomena, which is at the same time economical, judicial, moral, religious and aesthetical. Unravel both cultural and economic importance of the gift and its role in Asian societies. So, we are not only looking at gift in terms of something which is belonging to the social cultural realm, but brings in a lot of economic dimension. It is very important to understand that how it led to kind of a stability of the society, and two, it led helps in the movement of goods from one place to another, which was very important for the survival of the society. Acclaimed as a classical among anthropological texts, it is an example of comparative method, because at a large extent he is comparing number of society and also in terms of space and time. He is looking into some society, Asian societies and the present society. It presents the first systematic study of custom widespread in primitive societies from ancient Rome to present day Melanesia, of reciprocity and exchanging gift. So, through reading this classical text, we come across a lot of concepts. We try to have a clarity over a lot of concepts, economic transaction, exchange, reciprocity and so forth. But any work is not without critique. So, there is a number of critiques of the work by Marcel Mauss. The first critique is by Testart, who says that they are free gifts, such as passerby giving money to beggars in a large city. Donor and receivers do not know each other and are unlikely to ever meet again. In this context, the donation certainly creates no obligation on the side of beggar to reciprocate. Neither the donor nor the beggar has such an expectation. Moreover, the transaction does not establish a relationship between the two, much less a mutual interdependence. The second critique says that the social context of Indian Jain renouncers, a group of renouncers living an ascetic life of spiritual purification and salvation, and they have this whole idea that they are a believer in ahimsa, and ahimsa, they are not going to cause any violence. So any kind of preparation of food is considered as violence of microscopic organizer. So since they don't cook their own food, they are dependent on others for donation, and therefore this is also kind of based on free gift. So there are several critiques of Marcel Mauss, but what is very important is to keep in mind that his work in anthropology has influenced a large number of anthropologists after him. One of the most important influence of gift is to be seen in Levi-Strauss structuralism, where he looks at gift as a prototype of symbolic exchange and interpret it as basic mechanism underlying the creation of meaning. Then we look into his gifts become a significant background for feminist and Marxist understanding, and it's become a central idea to understand lot of economic exchange and transactions that is happening all around us. And when we read the book The Gift, it helps us not only to limit ourselves to a past society, but it helps us to understand the way in which gifts have become central in the life of modern, the so-called capitalist society. I hope after listening to the discussions and debates as discussed by Marcel Mauss, everyone who is listening to this kind of lecture will be tempted to read Marcel Mauss once. Thank you so much for the lecture.